I am the resurrection, and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys to hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. Friends, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of King Neal. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, in death, resurrection. I'm Pastor Mary Lee Sheffer, and I welcome you to Napa Methodist Church, Gary and King Neal's spiritual home. Will you join me in a word of prayer? Amazing and wonderful God who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Give to us now your grace that as we shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die. And when our days here are accomplished, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in you, and that nothing in life or in death can separate us from your great love. Amen. I invite you to stand as you're able as we sing together in the garden.
Still on the roses, and the boy. Would you join me in reading a responsive psalm this morning? Psalm 139. O eternal one, you have explored my heart and you know exactly who I am. You even know the small details like when I take a seat and when I stand up. Even when I am far away, you know what I'm thinking. You observe my wanderings and my sleeping, my waking and my dreaming. And you know everything I do in more detail than even I know. You know that I'm going to say long before I say it. It is true eternally that you know everything and everyone. Then you will be there to guide me. Your right hand will embrace me, for you are always there. Inside and out, you knitted me together in my mother's womb, long before I took my first breath. I will offer you my grateful heart, for I am your unique creation, filled with wonder and awe. Thank you. A reading from the book of Colossians, chapter 3. So if you're serious about living this new resurrection life with Christ, act like it. Pursue the things over which Christ presides. Don't shuffle along, eyes to the ground, absorbed with the things right in front of you. Look up, be alert to what is going around right in front of you. Look up and be alert to what is around Christ. That's where the action is. See things from his perspective. Your old life is dead. Your new life, which is your real life, even though the invisible of spectators, is with Christ and God. He is your life. When Christ, your real life, remember, shows up again on this earth, you'll show up too. The real you, the glorious you. Meanwhile, be content with obscurity, like Christ. Don't lie to one another. You're done with that old life. It's like a filthy set of ill-fitting clothes you stripped off and put in the fire. Now you're dressed in the new wardrobe. Every item of your new life is a custom-made piece by the Creator, with their label on it. All the old fashions are now obsolete. Words like Jewish and non-Jewish, religious and irreligious, insider and outsider, uncivilized and uncouth, slave and free mean nothing. From now on, everyone is defined by Christ. Everyone is included in Christ. So chosen by God for this new life, love, dress in wardrobe God picked out for you. Compassion, kindness, humility, quiet strength, discipline. Be even-tempered, content with second place. Quick to forgive an offense. Forgive as quickly and completely as the Master forgave you. And regardless of what else you put on, wear love. It's your basic all-purpose garment. Never be without it.
He chose this life of love, that key thread about it, about when she began to live what she called on God's time. She lost hair and she lost weight, but she continually put on the wardrobe that God had picked out for her. Compassion, kindness, humility, and quiet strength. God and I have got this, Kay frequently said, and we believed with her. With God's help, Kay knit together the loose ends of life, inviting all of us to turn away from worst-case scenarios on the internet and to focus on the miracles of the goodness and beauty of this ordinary life. If you've been Kay's Facebook friend, you've seen the Neal family farm through sunshine and shadow in every season. I think Kay's eye for beauty became refined in her illness, and she was able to see God in small, everyday moments, and she could even see God in us. Those of us who prayed with and for Kay were changed. We began by telling God what to do, a miracle, a reversal of the disease. And we learned to pay attention to God's healing and comforting presence with us, and to notice that Kay wore God's peace as if it were a prayer shawl. Kay was a gifted knitter who created sweaters and scarves and socks, and she was gifted at teaching others to knit as well. Many of the prayer shawls that our knitting ministry, Chicks with Sticks, have given to people who are in need of comfort were either stitched by Kay or held in her hands as we prayed over it. But not all of her knitting was done with yarn and needles. Kay was involved in rescue work, knitting together lives of thousands of stray and abandoned cats. The more bottle babies that needed to be fed every 2 hours, the better. And her rescue work included some quirky people and some lonely pastors. Kay's artist eye saw what many of us overlook, and with the eyes of her heart, she saw a loving God who became more real and more present to her as her body began to succumb to the cancer. I am a miracle. I believe in miracles, God, and I have got this. Gradually, those statements became, I love my life. I'm not afraid. Why does it take so long to die? And what will it be like? I asked Kate one time about the births of her three children, waiting and waiting for labor to begin, and then the hard work of pushing life into the world, and the wonder of holding someone that you just met and that you already fiercely love. I told Kate that I think death is like that. We're moving down a different passage where we are caught and held and loved by Jesus. And Kate said, I like how that sounds. It was an amazing gift to walk with Kate almost to the gates of heaven, and a more amazing gift to learn from her how to be present to life as it is, not how we want it to be, how it is, with grace and gratitude and love. Kay modeled that wardrobe described in the letter written thousands of years ago that Keith read to a people who were learning what it was to be followers of Jesus. Every item of your new way of life is custom made by the Creator with God's label on it. All the old fashions now are obsolete. Words like religious and irreligious, insider and outsider mean nothing. So chosen for this new life of love, dress in the wardrobe God picked out for you, forgiving completely. And regardless of what else you wear, put on love. It's your basic all-purpose garment. Never be without it. Love shows us who God is. And love helps knit the world together. Kay was skilled at knitting and loving, and those are her legacy. We don't need knitting needles or a devastating diagnosis to begin the work Kay was doing. We can start by being open to God, stitching love into our lives so that we can stitch love into the lives of others. We can help knit the world together. We can knit bomb the world. The parsonage guest room is pretty much full of Kay's yarn. And tomorrow afternoon at our house, there's wine and cheese and yarn to be had. If Kay has inspired you to knit or to love, to wear that all-purpose garment of God's love, there are knitting lessons here at Napa Methodist Church on Tuesday mornings, and love lessons every day that ends in Y. I want to invite Susan Sujikora.
Sunlight on your face.
Thank you, Susan. I'm the one who listed Kay's children in the program. Gary said that Cam's the funny one. And so I, and Beth is the youngest, and I thought, maybe she's always last, so she'll be second. But just because your names are in this order doesn't mean that this is how you have to talk. And I'm telling the rest of us that there's an insert in the program. And so I feel like if I just said a show of hands, you have a special memory of Kay. Come on. Okay, well, we can't all speak today. So that's what this is for. And I want to invite Cam and Beth and Andy in whatever order you want to come.
I'm going to try to get through this. I'm Andy. I'm the eldest child of Gary and Kay. I want to thank everybody for being here today. Family and friends. I know that some people have traveled far. I guarantee you Mom is with us right now, and she is very happy. She is with us today. You're thinking, what do I say about Mom in a couple minutes in front of all these people? The word that kept coming to my mind was the word connection. Because that was what Mom was all about. Family and friends connecting with each other and connecting with her. And I think that's why we're all here today, because you all had a connection with Mom. That defined her life. I had another little memory came to my mind. It's a little funny. Countless conversations with Mom over the years about, you know, I'd tell her something, I'd say, you know, hey, I was out with my friends William and Kevin recently, and we bumped into John. And Mom would always be like, I mean, the point of the story is I was with my two friends that she knows, and she would ask, who's John? And I was like, oh, Mom, you don't know him. That's not really the point of the story. But Mom was establishing that connection in her mind and giving that to me. And then, lo and behold, John would come up again, and she goes, was that the one that was with you, William and Kevin? Because it was always about the connection we had as family and friends. For years, I had Friday morning coffee with Mom. We probably bumped into a few of you out in front of Pete's. We'd sit there for an hour Friday mornings. I'd sneak up from work. Mom would come down and meet me, and we would sit for an hour and talk about everybody and everything. We did that for years. And we were constantly interrupted because people would walk by. It's a busy shopping center, and Mom has a connection with everybody. And she would absolutely 100% engage with whoever stopped to say hi to us. And I actually, some ways, would get annoyed because that was my time with Mom. But again, it was always about the connection with the people around us. In Mom's final days, we knew it was coming. And Dad and I would, actually not just us, but we would often have we call it 5 o'clock wine. Mom would take a Tylenol and have a glass of wine, that would kind of help her get through the evening. And towards the end, we knew what was happening, and Mom said, you know, if I can't sit here and have 5 o'clock wine with my husband and my son, if I can't be present and chit-chat with a friend who stops by in the middle of the day, if I can't answer my phone and have that conversation and work on that connection, she told me her life was complete and she was okay with that. Because that's what it was for her. I'd ask for you to look around this room for a moment.
And just look at the people in this room. We're here because Mom connected us. I imagine you're going to see some sad eyes. I would ask you to give them a comforting glance to that person. You might see a stranger in the room. I'd ask you to give them a welcoming glance. And if you see a family member, which I've spread out sprinkled throughout this room, give them a knowing Goodman smile. Mom, thank you for my life. Thank you for your life and connecting me to this world. Every person in this room is better because you had a connection with my mom. Thank you.
Said, I remember your mom just cheering her tail off at all our games. She was so loud and so supportive, specifically the basketball games and the stands, and she would go nuts up there. My basketball team won about 7 games, so it makes me wonder if Dad would have cheered a little bit more. Here today, but here over the course of the last few weeks, the outpouring of love and support over the course of Mom's 3-year battle, especially the last few weeks. And while I like to think that our family is pretty tough, every car, text, email, phone call, every hug, word of encouragement, arm around the shoulder, all of that, it did mean the world to us, and it was needed to keep us on our feet. My mom had a very strong faith and love for God, family, and community. She's got the biggest smile right now. We're in her church, hanging out with God, her family, and her community. The only thing missing is about 100 cats. Please tell me there's not cats. This is the last scarf my mom made by her passing. And I grabbed it. It's not for me necessarily, but I wanted to speak to it today because at some point, her hands and more specifically her fingers began this journey. And at some point, they were not able to finish it. Pastor Mary Lee has a computer number off of it, 8x11. The more I think about it, I'm not sure that she was really meant to finish this project. And in fact, I'm pretty sure the plan all along was for me to have it here today. To bring some comfort. Not necessarily the comfort of a warming scarf, but the comfort we should all feel that there is a heaven, and my mom is she's there. So maybe the scarf represents life, and now I'm an English teacher, so here I go. Maybe the scarf represents life, and the well-constructed tight rows are the good times. And then the frayed ends and the loose rows are the challenging times. I'm not sure. And maybe the question, though, that we should really be asking ourselves is, what yarn are you using to weave the life experience? And so I can tell you this. My mom used the most loving yarn in the market, and she made sure to leave some behind the rest of us. So Mom, thanks for loving me. Thanks for loving my wife, Holly. Thanks for loving my kids. I miss you.
Everyone else had a paper, so I grabbed mine, but this is a program, because there's a paper. I just wanted to share a couple of memories that I really think exemplifies my mom and the love she had for everybody. When you were with her, whoever you were, she brought out the best version of you. And she did that with my birth mom, too, before I was even born. When she knew the night I was born, she got to the hospital where I was born in San Jose. And she always tells me the story on my birthday, every birthday. but I know it. And she always told me, like, I got to the hospital and I knew where you were, but I went to check on her birth mom first. I needed to make sure she was okay. You know, I knew you were okay. I needed to make sure she was okay. And when my birth mom was pregnant, she would, you know, stock the fridge and just show her so much love. And actually, I have so many letters from my birth mom that I organized into a binder recently. And they were to me. They were to my mom. but it's pretty cool. They were the ones that were close and had the relationship. It's pretty awesome. And that's how much she loved me. She loved where I came from, and she never made me feel any type of way. But, you know, I just felt so blessed that she was my mom. She was always meant to be my mom, and both of us knew that. All three of us knew that. And then as I started growing up, most of our conversations were me following her around the yard as she would clip flowers. And, you know, I'd be venting about all my stuff, and she would just keep clipping flowers, and those were just our deepest talks, and it was just so special. Babe, what was the last point I was gonna talk about? Oh, the cats. Okay. How could I forget? How could I forget? So, when I was going through a particularly tough time about 10 years ago, my mom was there every step of the way. And I had this wild idea that I wanted to foster cats. And she's like, Beck, we already have like 4. Like, what do you mean? And I was like, well, I want to like foster them. Like, we could put them in Cam's old room, you know. And then after a while, it leaked into the breakfast room and the dining room and the living room. And Dad put the foot down in the kitchen, which I agree with. So, but yeah, that started with me begging her to, and it's just so amazing how many lives she's touched because she chose to put so much love and time into helping these little beings, you know. Every time I'd visit home, sometimes I would sleep in my old bed and I'd wake up and the free rangers would, I'd wake up with like 6, like literally I counted 6 little weights around the bed and I'd see like shadows of like 2 ears around the bed. And I totally didn't move because I didn't want to wake them up. But yeah, she impacted so many people's lives, and I think this room just, it only shows a small portion of the impact she left in this world. Yeah, she was an amazing woman, and I'll continue to carry what she would tell me to do during certain times, and I know what she would say, and yeah, I'm just so grateful. I'll be I'll be who I am and continue to become is because of who she was. So, and that's it.
If I read the program right, I believe we have a slide, and we don't have any pets so far, so good. We have a slideshow. My sister-in-law Holly and I have been working on this for a few days, and we got a little carried away at first. It came out to be about 28 minutes long. So I cut and sliced and edited, and it's down to about 6 minutes. It's now full, so bear with us, but I hope you enjoy what we prepared. Thank you.
I
This is the open-ended prayer. We would hold on to people we love. But sometimes we have to let them go. So I invite you to be in this attitude of prayer, for the prayer of letting Kate go back to God. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you are still God. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. To all who sorrow, your peace. Eternal God, you have shared with us the life of Kate Neal, and before she was ours, she has always been yours. For all that Kate has given us to make us what we are, and for that of her which lives and grows in each of us, and for her life that in your love will never end, we give you thanks. As we now offer Kate back into your arms, comfort us in our loneliness, strengthen us in our weakness, and give us courage to face the future unafraid. Draw those of us who remain in this life closer to one another. Make us faithful to serve one another, and give us to know that peace and joy, which is eternal life. We pray this in your holy and wondrous name, and let's respond, amen. I invite us to pray a Celtic Lord's Prayer. Ground of all being, Mother of all, Father of the universe, your name is sacred beyond speaking. May we know your presence. May your longings be our longings in heart and in action. May there be food for the human family today and for the whole earth community. Forgive us the falseness of what we have done as we forgive those who are untrue to us. Do not forsake us in our time of conflict, but lead us into new beginnings. For the light of life, the vitality of life, and the glory of life are yours now and forever. Amen.
Please stand as you're able as we sing together the hymn.
So now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forevermore. Amen. And praise God for the life of Mary Catherine Goodman Neal.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. You get to go.